Dr. Nasser, in your role as chairman of the CEPC, you're obviously engaging with government stakeholders, the private sector. What, in your view, can governments do more to increase the uptake and diversification of the energy sector?
Right. Thank you. Just a word about the CEPC. So we're a clean energy business council. It groups together both businesses, governments, international organizations like UNEP, UNDP, IFC and others. And the idea is really to promote clean energy, clean technology across the region. And of course, it's a membership organization, and all of you are welcome to become members of the CEPC. So in answer a little bit to your question, I think the most important thing is that we need to price fossil fuels efficiently. That's the number one priority for all the governments of the region. I say that because we continue to subsidize fossil fuels. If you look at the latest numbers we have on a global basis, the cost of fossil fuel subsidies exceeds $5.3 trillion. That's $5.3 trillion. That's about 6.5% of global GDP. You look at the emerging markets and developing countries, the cost of fossil fuel subsidies runs between 13 to 18% of GDP. In the MENA region, we're running at around 14% of GDP goes for fossil fuel subsidies. Now, what do we mean by that? The cost includes, of course, the fact that there are externalities, that when you're using fossil fuels and you're subsidizing it, you're using your cars, pollutes the air, it raises temperature. There are health costs as well. As a result of that, there are deaths because people use their cars more frequently, and that is the total cost. So the first thing that you need to do in the region is to remove the fossil fuel subsidies. Those continue to be large. They represent a large proportion of the budget. The country that has moved the fastest in removing the subsidies is the UAE, and we now have flexible pricing. But we need to go much further, in my view. And I'm not going to make myself popular by saying that we need, if we're going to be consistent with the commitments we have made to COP21 and COP22 and COP23, we need to impose a carbon tax. We need to impose a carbon tax on diesel, on gasoline, and other fuels that you use. By doing so, you free up resources that governments can then use for renewable energy. But the number one priority has to be raising the prices and eventually imposing a carbon tax. So let me give you an example in the case of Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, as you know, is running large budget deficits because oil prices are low. But yet, fossil fuels, the cost of diesel and gasoline in Saudi Arabia, some of the lowest in the world. If they want to deal with the carbon inefficiencies that arise, their carbon footprint, they would need to impose a tax of around 50 cents per liter. This would about more than double the existing price. But if they did that, they would be able to raise revenue of around $60 billion. That would cover 80% of the deficit. You wouldn't need any other types of taxes. So I submit to you the number one priority has to be fossil fuels and imposing carbon taxes. The second thing that is important is that climate change needs to be integrated with development policy, by which I mean that it is not sufficient to talk about the strategy and policies and regulations. You need to integrate climate change as part of your overall economic development. And what that means is that it has to come at the forefront. Again, an example, the UAE. The UAE now has a Minister of Climate Change. That means that you've raised the profile of climate change to cabinet level. It means the discussion about climate change happens with all the ministries involved. And the next step is to say each of the ministries, whether it's the Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Energy, any of the ministries need to take into account climate change in terms of what they do. And that, of course, means that, and this is the second plank, is that we need the laws and regulations to conform with that. If I look across the region, a number of countries, Egypt, Jordan, UAE, have all taken some steps in the right direction. But I'd like, for those who are interested, go to the Grantham Institute at the London School of Economics. They have a survey, a global survey, of laws and regulations related to climate change and the environment. Very useful tool. It gives an overview in terms of what are you doing in terms of the environment, a green transport, disaster risk, low carbon, etc. So very useful. If I look at the ranking of the Arab countries in the MENA region, we're still very low in terms of developing those laws and regulations.
Yes. Yes, I agree.
The second or third part, we've talked about laws, the first part is subsidies. The third part, I think, has got to be the issue of climate finance and de-risking climate change financing. Why do I mention this? Because at the moment, our banks and financial institutions have not adequately priced the risk of fossil fuel assets. If, as is the case now, you're going to be using more and more renewables and therefore less and less fossil fuel with time, and the price of fossil fuels is likely to go down with time because of competition from new technologies, particularly solar, then you run the risk that many of the assets, much of the oil that we have in the ground, will become a stranded asset. That is, it has no longer the economic value required to extract it from the ground. That means that our banks and financial institutions will be financing assets that no longer have economic value. So another priority that needs to take place is that we need to have regulations on the financial disclosure with respect to climate risk that is still not yet in place. The BIS, the IMF, and others are still working on this, but at the moment we still don't have a regulation requiring our banks and financial institutions to declare what the financial risks are related to climate change. And that has to happen both at the level of the banking and financial sector, but also at the level of the corporates. Our businesses need to start recognizing that climate change represents a big risk. So the big heading really is that climate change risk is systemic risk. It affects the whole banking and financial sector, and therefore affects the corporate sector. As a result of that, and perhaps we can discuss that in the panel, we need to be much more active in terms of climate change finance, and in particular things like political risk insurance is going to become more and more important. Political risk insurance is important because you need to attract private capital to go into renewable energy projects to serve large segments of the population. And in order for the private sector to do that, it needs the reassurance that policies of government will not change, because we're talking about projects which can have a long lifetime of 10, 15, 20 years. So political risk insurance is going to be important. An initiative that has been launched recently is insurance resilience, which is meant to give guarantees and offer insurance for some 400 million people around the earth that are exposed to climate change. So there are a number of initiatives that we in this part of the world need to think of in terms of how do we ensure sufficient financing to go into renewables and address climate change. So maybe I'll just rest at that.
Thank you, Nasser. That's very interesting.